Informal financial transfers are ubiquitous in low-income communities in both rich and poor countries. These are typically viewed positively as they enable risk-sharing when formal insurance or social safety nets may be missing. But do these benefits come at a cost? Social insurance may turn into social taxation if the pressure to share earned income reduces an individual's incentive to work and distorts their labor supply decisions. To help motivate this idea, this figure plots the relationship between average hours worked per week and the prevalence of informal transfers across social groups in West Africa, Côte d'Ivoire, Indonesia, and the United States. In all cases, hours worked are lower among groups where informal transfers are more prevalent. These patterns, of course, are merely correlations, but they suggest that informal redistributive arrangements may dampen labor supply incentives. This paper develops a causal test to examine this possibility. The authors designed and implemented a randomized controlled trial among 474 full-time female factory workers in Côte d'Ivoire. Workers are employed in cashew processing plants, where the entirety of their earnings are based on the number of nuts they peel. They are paid twice a month in cash, and there is substantial redistributive pressure at baseline. Workers report transferring 25 to 35% of their earnings on average to people outside their household, and 77% agree or strongly agree with the statement. If someone starts earning more money because they have decided to work harder, people would start asking that person more often for financial help. It is also seen as socially costly to deny these requests. 80% of workers believe that refusing to share such income gains would be seen as unacceptable. But there is an exception. Workers can turn down transfer requests with no or muted consequences if they can credibly claim to have insufficient funds to share. Drawing on this insight, and in collaboration with one of the largest banks in Côte d'Ivoire, the authors designed a blocked savings account to help shield workers' savings from redistributive pressure. When opening an account, workers choose a threshold which must be weekly higher than their baseline earnings. Then, in each pay cycle, any amount they earn above this threshold is automatically deposited by the factory into the blocked account, which cannot be accessed until the end of the blocked period. The remainder of their earnings is paid in cash as usual. Workers were randomized into three groups. Those in the control were not offered a blocked account, and among workers who were offered an account, the authors varied the extent to which their savings were shielded from transfer requests. Those in the private group were offered an account whose existence was not revealed to anyone else, while those in the non-private group were offered an account whose existence and approximate unblock date were made known to others in the workers' network. This was explained as a way for the bank to advertise its blocked account product to the community, but it also reduces the account's usefulness as a way to avoid transfer requests. And the results show this has a significant effect on workers' desire for a blocked account. In phase one of the experiment, a subset of workers was randomized into either the private or control condition, and of those offered a private account, 43% took them up. In phase two, workers were randomized into either the private or non-private account group, and take-up of private accounts increased to 60%, while take-up of non-private accounts was only 14%. Blocked accounts are much less desirable when their existence is known to one's network, and 96% of those who were offered and declined a non-private account said an important factor in their decision was that other people's knowledge of the account would lead to an increase in transfer requests. But the real indication that redistributive pressure distorts workers' incentives is that being offered a private account leads to sizable increases in labor supply and earnings. Relative to the control or non-private condition, the private arm increases workers' total output, and therefore their earnings, by 11.4%. This is driven, in part, by a 9.7% increase in attendance at work, and the overall increase in earnings is equivalent to what a worker could achieve by working an additional 1.19 days in every two-week pay cycle. Thus, reducing the likelihood of transfer requests has a marked impact on individuals' willingness to work. Consistent with this, the effects of being offered a private account are concentrated amongst those who reported facing greater redistributive pressure at baseline. The authors estimate that the social tax rate faced by the average worker in their sample is 9-14%, and is as high as 19-23% for the subset of workers who actually take up private accounts. As a final note, it's worth emphasizing that these patterns of redistributive pressure are not specific to this study's setting in Côte d'Ivoire. In the United States, for example, a meaningful share of low-income Black and Hispanic individuals also reports facing redistributive pressure, which suggests these findings reflect broad patterns of social taxation. To the extent these dynamics distort an individual's incentive to work, further research should explore whether they also affect the willingness to undertake other actions that could increase future income, such as adopting new technologies or investing in human capital. To read more on this topic, you can check out the paper's references to other related work. This includes many papers on redistributive pressure, including its impact on economic behavior, and broader work on labor supply and productivity in low-income settings.